Hello and welcome to News and Views. I'm John Banville. Our guest this week is Senator Marty Golden. Senator Golden, thank you very much for being here today.
John, thank you very much.
I'm glad that you took some time out of your busy schedule to let our viewers know about a very important thing in their lives, although they may not realize it initially. The state budget has been proposed. Governor Cuomo has unveiled his spending plan for the 2014 legislative year, and it affects a lot of people in a lot of different ways. Understanding that it's a very thick document, that there are a lot of complexities involved, and that we just received it yesterday, I was wondering your reaction to the broad outlines of what Governor Cuomo is proposing to do in his state budget this year. I know that you have several very real concerns, and there have been, you've been working diligently to improve the economic vitality of our state. Do you think the state budget as it's been proposed is working to benefit the people of Brooklyn?
Well, believe it or not, I do. I think the move that the governor has made over the past several years, and including this year and this year's budget, is by taking a $10 billion deficit and going, not only getting that $10 billion deficit off of our rolls, but giving us a $200 plus into our bank here in the state of New York going forward. He was smart enough and wise enough to be able to put into a tax freeze, a cap across the state of New York, and he was smart enough to put a spending cap as well, which allowed us to get to where we are today. And as long as we continue on that spending cap across the state of New York, and it's not a spending cap in a city, it's across the state, and we would hope that we would mind our spending here in the city of New York going forward and make sure that we don't increase spending and keep the taxes down as a whole for the people here in our great city. So he's done, I think, a great job, and I think the tax cap has helped us to be able to afford to the people of our city. We have a renter's credit coming in, $100 million, that anybody makes $100,000 or less will be able to be part of that tax credit that will give them some relief, so they'll have some extra money in their pockets at the end of the year. And if you make less than $200,000 and you own your own home, you'll also be part of that here in the city of New York. Since I think that's all positive and all good. We started some years ago, we created an infrastructure committee here. Senator Joe Robach, myself, and others sat down and said, we need to do something about the infrastructure. What we've seen come out of that is the Tappan Zee Bridge. Now we're starting to see what the infrastructure is going to be across 100 bridges across the state of New York. That's going to put a tremendous number of people to work, and that's going to help to build our coffers as well. So I think the infrastructure is very important. The cap and giving the people more money in their property and in their renters more ability to save money, and looking at putting a $2 billion bond forward for education and being able to have the technology that we need and to expand on pre-K, not only in the city of New York, but pre-K across the state, all day pre-K across the state of New York. And I think that is something that's important. And of course, you talked about Common Core and some of the issues in Common Core, the testing up to, you know, pre-K first and second grade. There's a real contention out there that that should not be there, and I believe that that it shouldn't. I believe that the core curriculum and those earlier grades is very difficult, the testing portion of it. I think core curriculum itself is very good for us going forward. I think the process is moving so quickly that I think we got to slow the process down a little bit, and we got to get on top of that process. So I believe a delay is something that I think the people in the state of New York would look to for the future is a good way to go. So he's come out with some good policy, and he's come out with some good money issues that I believe are good for the taxpayers here in the state of New York. So we're going to work closely with him. There are other issues that we're going to get into in creating the jobs and creating economic development and looking to give the ability for people to stay and live and reside in Brooklyn and their children to get jobs and to be able to go forward. And you'll see that in the tax-free New York and in other segments that we'll talk about over the course of this year and, of course, during this program here.
One of the major components of the governor's proposed budget includes a reliance on a federal waiver. Can you tell us, particularly for Medicaid, can you tell us a little bit about where we stand in this process and what it would and what it means to the people of Brooklyn, this Medicaid waiver, and if it's important to them?
Well, the that in itself is probably a two-hour program. The Medicaid waiver that we talk about is across the country. It's 37 states. Texas, California have it. For whatever reason, we applied and we've saved $17 billion in Medicaid. That was the whole purpose for the Medicaid waiver, is whatever money that you were able to save, you would be able to get a portion of that back to right-size your hospitals, your nursing homes, your assisted living facilities, and making sure that we have good health care here in our city and in Brooklyn. So the ironic part of this is that Brooklyn is ground zero. Brooklyn is ground zero for health care when it comes not just to the city and to the state, but to the federal government. How goes Brooklyn, goes this nation. So these other states have been able to get this waiver, and for whatever reason, we've applied for it. $10 billion is what we've asked for and we are entitled to. And they keep raising the bar, the level that of need and the reasons for the Medicaid waiver for Texas, for California some years ago. It was different, and today, if we had the same bar, we would have gotten that Medicaid waiver. New York is always the, I guess, the state and the city itself that gets kicked around as, you know, one of those, it would cost the federal government a lot of money to operate. But they forget that 9.5 million people live in a city, 19.5 million people live in the in this great state, and there's something around 47 people in the city of New York alone speak a second language at home. I have close to 60 languages spoken in my schools and in my hospitals, just to give you an idea of the complexity of the city of New York. So, having said that, we have a number of hospitals, right? Litch is on the, wants to get closed, right? That's a SUNY property, right? That's right. Operated by SUNY and University Hospital. They're losing $13 million a year. There were several proposals. There was a proposal on the table last week where NYU and Lutheran Medical were going to go in there and operate that facility. I understand Brooklyn Hospital now has put in a proposal, and there might be a third proposal. So they've opened up the proposal process for another 2 weeks. Let the proposals in, they'll review them, they'll bring everybody to the table, and hopefully we can come down on a closure where they'll get a freestanding emergency room, they'll have urgent care centers around the community, they'll have primary care facilities around the community, and they'll have some other healthcare areas that will be needed for that community, ambulatory care and others that will also be part of the package. So, and then of course there'll be housing above that, whether it be condo, co-op, or rental, whatever the story may be, but we need to get that done. They're losing $13 million. They're down about $500 million today. If they were to sell off the properties, they get $250 million. That still leaves SUNY and University Hospital $250 million in the hole. You got Interfaith, you got Brookdale, you have Wyckoff losing another $7 million a month. So you just cannot sustain these losses and continue to sustain these losses because this is just one borough. So I said, you know, as I said in my statement that this is ground zero for healthcare, it is. So that money from that Medicaid waiver would be able to help us to right-size these hospitals, to give us the ability to do what we have to do, to get Litch off of SUNY's balance sheet, and to allow Litch to go on to exist for many, many years to come. So that's what you want to do. You want to change the footprints in some of these locations. Mm-hmm. You want to change their medical plans going forward. And you want to make sure that the health care in those communities and primary care is addressed and that there's enough health care. So whatever you do in Brooklyn, will eventually be done in the Bronx. It'll be done in New York City. It'll be done in Westchester and in Buffalo and in Utah and other cities, states, towns, villages around the country. So the sooner we get that done, the better. So what we're asking is the federal government to do that. Give us the money we're entitled to. Give us that Medicaid waiver. Stop playing games. You're playing with people's lives, and you're paying with dollars that we could use for education, for health care, for other areas. If we're losing that type of money a month just in Brooklyn, mm-hmm. just in Brooklyn, there is a report by the Commissioner of Health that there are 237 hospitals that are on some need of help across mm-hmm. the state
it's
of New York.
Stress, yes.
So if we have that much going on, that $10 billion that would come in from the federal government would help us. We would not be able to solve all of our problems, but it would be able to stop the bleeding, help us to right size the institutions, get us the better health care system that we need for the people across the city and the state of New York, and to be able to turn and have a balanced budget going forward where we could spend money in better ways and reduce taxes for all people across this great city and state, not increase them, and drive people out of the city and state. And that's what we're doing. We're driving our young out of the city and state. They can't get jobs here, and they can't afford to stay here. And so you're losing a real tax base that helps us to provide the needs of the have-nots across our great city and across our great state. So we need to be able to come up with a good compromise. I think the governor's working in the right direction. We're working with the Assembly and the Senate Democrats, as well as the Republicans, working with this governor to go after the federal government. Give us that health care waiver ASAP.
This is a bottom line issue, isn't it, Senator? It's almost do or die, isn't it?
Well, it is. It's a shame that you use that word, do or die, but if you think about it, it's people today.
Access denied to health care, Senator.
Correct.
People could.
Correct. Correct.
I mean,
there's no doubt
scary
about that. This is, that's all I, you know, every week I go home to my community, I tell them there's a wake or a funeral I'm going to. You know, it's not getting any better. And the communities of Kings County and Queens County are two of the oldest communities in the entire country. We have the highest quantities of seniors in living in Kings and Queens, and we need to be able to make sure that they not only get the health care, but they get the golden years that they deserve. And good health care, the ability to live and stay in their homes, and have that as a goal of this great nation and this great city and state to allow it to happen.
Senator Golden, it's all the time we have for this week. I'd like to have you on in future shows to discuss some of the more, I'd like updates on what's happening with the Medicaid waiver, but some of the more detailed components of the state budget as we go through the process. I want to thank you very much for your time.
You're quite welcome, and we should get into economic development. That's going to be something about keeping jobs here and moving forward with this city and state in the right direction.
Absolutely.
Thank you, John.
We'll see you soon.
Thank you.